Good morning, Mississippi Avenue. How are you doing? Welcome to Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday. This is a day that offers us hope. And in that hope, it also offers us confidence. Confidence in our God. Confidence in His ultimate success, His victory. Please stand with us as we sing, Prepare Ye the Way. We are going to prepare the way in our hearts for our Lord this morning.
Rejoice, the Lord is King. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and let's remember the victims of the bombings in Egypt today. It's a sad day over there. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we just come to you right now, and we do lift up the families and the ones that survived the bombings. And we, Father, we know that you're working all things out for the good for those that love you and called according to your purpose. We just ask that you'll just give a peace that passes understanding for all those that are dealing with the loss. Father, for here today, we just ask that you'll just empower our worship, empower the preaching, that, Father, we might walk out of here changed, closer to you, that others might see Jesus in us. In his name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Be seated. Today is Palm Sunday. We are celebrating Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. And we have lots of events coming up, and if you take a look in your bulletin just for a second, you'll see those coming up. If you're a guest here at Mississippi Avenue Baptist Church, we ask that you'll take a moment, fill out the section there that asks for information, fill out all the information you feel comfortable giving, and we'll be in contact with you through an email or maybe even a letter later on. If you have a prayer request, we ask that you'll just write that down at the bottom, and also praise, you can fill that in there. Also, and we'll make sure we pray for those on Tuesday staff meeting, and then we'll also rejoice with you in praising what God is doing in your life. God's alive, is that correct? Yeah. All right, so it's exciting to be here at church today. I just remembered a Bible verse. I was glad when they said to me, "Let us go into the house of the Lord." So I hope you're glad you're here today. Let's spend some time shaking hands. Guess what? I get to do children's sermons. So if you're an old kid and you want to hear me talk, come on down front. All right, let's stand and shake hands.
seated.
Hello, boys and girls. Some of you got way over there. Hello. Yeah, I know what happens when you get way over there. This is what happens. Yeah. Hi, guys. You okay over there? Can I have a lollipop? Is he only got one? Okay. That doesn't stop a youth guy from eating the lollipops. Guess where I've been? Anybody remember where I went to besides the barber? Where did it go?
Mexico.
Mexico, man. You are awesome. High five. Is that all you got? Come on, give it to me. That's better. All right. Very good. And I brought back a little coin from Mexico. Does anybody know what a coin from Mexico is called? I heard whispers. Yeah, no, not. Anybody know what a coin from Mexico is called? It's peso. It's a peso. And this is, it's a coin from Mexico. Yeah, okay. So I brought one little coin back from Mexico. It's a peso. I brought something else back from Mexico. Yeah, yeah. It's empty, as you know. It's a Mexican Coke. It's down there, it cost about 70 pesos for one of these. Right, Mike? Are you on your phone? Yeah, thank you. You should be in the youth group with that. All right. So for 70 of these, you can buy one of those. But I also got something from Mexico you can't buy. And she's bringing it up here. Now, it's not a real sword, okay? It's not a, see, if it's a real short sword, I wouldn't grab it like this, okay? Wow, yeah. Yeah, it's nice. They gave it to me. I didn't actually take it off the wall. It actually goes on your wall. It goes like this, all right? And it has a little spinny thing here. That's the most fascinating part about it. It keeps spinning, okay? But this is what they told me it was, even for those way down there. It has some writing in Spanish here, all the way across. And, yeah, what it says is the sword of the Spirit. Yeah, the sword of the Spirit. Sorry, did I hit you with it? Okay. My bad. Ooh, I think you got me too. So, what, you know, we know what a peso is used for. A peso can be used, if you get 70 of them, you can get one of these. But what is the sword of the Spirit used for? Anybody know? What?
It's about the Spirit.
It's about the Spirit. Very good. Yes, you'll have to shout because you're so far away. Very good. In Ephesians chapter 6, it talks about that. How did that work out? I don't know how that worked out. Yeah. Listen up. Yes? Very good. Spirit of the Lord. In Ephesians chapter 6, in verse 10, let me see if I can get enough light to read this. All right, it says, that was a joke, okay. Y'all are pretty rough out there, okay. All right, in Ephesians chapter 6, in verse 10, the Apostle Paul writes, says, finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. In his mighty power. It talks about, then a little later on, it talks about taking up the sword of the Spirit. Because guess what? We're in a battle. We're in a battle to do the right thing every day, okay? Whether it's at school or with your parents when they tell you to go clean up your room and you go, no! None of you ever do that, do you? No. Yeah. Out of the mouth of babes. Out of the mouth of babes. So, guess what? Whether you're little kids up here sitting here or big kids out there, we're still in the battle. So let's pray to Jesus that he'll help us. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you promised never to leave us or forsake us. And so, Father, I pray for these boys and girls, and I also pray for everyone in this room that we'll take up the sword of the Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, go back to your seats, please. Thank you.
So we introduced this song to you last week. We're going to sing one verse again in a chorus. The second verse, I'm going to ask you to stand and sing with us.
My heart and on every word that you speak.
us as we sing it. Your touch. Tells us, bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my Lord God, you are very great. You are clothed in splendor and majesty, covering yourself with light as with a garment, stretching out the heavens like a tent. Let's sing. Thank you. Let's sing Hosanna.
Good morning, church. Excited to see you all here today. Now, there is sort of a clever new way to refer to some people who aren't normally involved in church. Now, if you've been in church for any amount of time, you've heard of the phrases lost and saved, and those are still both helpful and true phrases. But I'd like to introduce you to a couple new terms. And these are nuns and duns. And you may have heard of them already. Now, the nuns are those who claim no religious affiliation. Now, maybe their parents or their grandparents were Baptist or Methodist or Catholic or whatever. But they themselves have no affiliation. They claim no affiliation, really, with any faith. Now, the scary thing is that the nuns are a rapidly growing group in our country. There's another, the duns. And the duns are those who may have grown up in church, but no longer have anything to do with it. So the duns are those who have been there, done that, and have the church camp t-shirt, or 30. Now, while they're a hard sell, many of the nuns and duns will come to church. All it takes is an invitation. All it takes is an invitation. Although they may want to know what's happening at your church. I want to encourage you to invite friends, neighbors, colleagues, classmates, family, to come to the events this weekend, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, although they may really need to be told what's going on. So we're going to celebrate the last week of Jesus Christ. And what we need you to do is to invite people to participate. We can no longer assume that people will just show up to church. There are far too many nuns and duns. Now, I want to encourage you to watch this video, as it's a bit of silly encouragement for us to invite other people to church.
No.
Huh?
Well, over to the left.
Okay.
Need a photographer? Yeah, sure.
Thanks.
Thanks.
So where'd you guys go off to all dressed up this morning?
Oh, church. Easter services.
How nice. How nice. What did your pastor preach about this morning at this church service?
I'm sorry?
You know, what was the sermon about?
Oh, Jesus.
Uh-huh.
You know, how he conquered death, right? You know.
Uh-huh.
I mean, and he gave us, you know, life.
Uh-huh.
Abundantly.
Huh. Interesting. Very interesting. Hey, you didn't think my wife and I need to hear about that this morning? That wasn't on your radar? No? Say cheese!
So I want to reassure you, this week will be a gospel-saturated week. It'll be a gospel-saturated weekend. Invite your friends to our Good Friday service. It'll be at 6 o'clock this Friday. Invite them, if they have kids or if they have grandkids or if they know of children, invite them to Extravaganza on Saturday at 2. And then invite them to Easter Sunday next morning. We'll have two services, one at 8 o'clock, one at 10:45. And don't worry, they won't hear a sermon on tithing. I'm not going to talk about marriage. I'm not going to talk about the things that scare people off of church. What we're going to talk about is Jesus Christ. We're going to talk about His life, His death, and His resurrection. And there are people across the street from your house, next to your house, and mine, people you'll see at lunch today, people who need to hear about the gospel. They're not just going to show up. They might get, you know, we've got these flyers that we put in your worship guide to make it easier for you to invite people to church. We're even sending out stuff in the mail this week. So we're going to have people around our church who are going to get something in the mail. But I'm telling you, there is nothing like an invitation. There's nothing like a personal invitation. Come with me to church. I'll pick you up. I'll drive you there. I'll buy you a donut. Whatever it takes, you just bring people to church. It's a great week to invite those nuns and those duns. Because people are still fascinated with Jesus. They may want nothing to do with the church. They may think that organized religion is bad. They may think that pastors are only after their pocketbook. We're not. But they're still fascinated by Jesus. And that's who they'll hear about this weekend. Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So please, don't assume that your neighbor will go to church. Don't assume that your colleague, your classmate, or anybody like that will just show up because it's Easter. Invite them to come with you next Sunday. Join me, open your Bibles to Luke chapter 19. In a moment, we'll start in verse 28. So open your Bibles, the one in your lap or the one on your phone, to Luke 19. We're going to start in 28 in just a moment. Today is Palm Sunday, as you've already heard, we've already sang about. The day that Jesus entered into Jerusalem. And this passage is going to tell us both a compelling and complicated story about what it meant for Jesus to enter Jerusalem riding on a donkey to the shouts and the praise of the crowds. Let's read in Luke chapter 19. We're going to start in verse 28. When he had said these things, he went on ahead going up to Jerusalem. When he drew near to Bethpage and Bethany, at the mount that is called Olivet, he sent two of his disciples, saying, "Go into the village in front of you, where on entering you will find a colt tied, on which no one has ever yet sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' you shall say this, 'The Lord has need of it.' So those who were sent went away and found it just as Jesus had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owner said to them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' And they said, 'The Lord has need of it.' And they brought it to Jesus, and throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus upon it. And as he rode along, they spread their cloaks on the road. And as he was drawing near, already on the way down the Mount of Olives, the multitude of his disciples began to rejoice, praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest.' And some of the Pharisees and the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.' And he answered, 'I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out.'" Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the truthfulness of your word. We thank you for the example of Jesus Christ. We praise you that Jesus entered Jerusalem knowing exactly what he was doing and where he was going, and exactly how the week would end. We praise you that he still went. Lord, we confess that we need you. We need you here. We need you with us. We need you this very hour. Speak to us. Holy Spirit, speak to us that we may know exactly what we need to hear. Where we need conviction, bring conviction. Where we need encouragement, bring encouragement. And Lord, speak to those who may not have a relationship with you. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Now, all four of the Gospels, this is a little bit unique, that all four of the Gospels, not all four of the Gospels even talk about Jesus' birth, but all four of the Gospels will zoom in on this last week, what was called the Holy Week or the Passion Week. It's the last week of Jesus. And they all do this because it is the greatest week in history. Now, it's the greatest week because of what happened. What Jesus did, what Jesus taught, and the victory that Jesus achieved. About 40% of the Gospels, 40% of the Gospels are all about this one week from Palm Sunday to Easter Sunday. Now, this is not too different from when Hollywood, they will take a book and they adapt it into a movie. Now, this is nice because the authors of the Gospels do it without aggravation, right? So when Hollywood takes your favorite book, they turn it into the movie, there's nothing but aggravation when you see what happens. Because the directors, when they convert a book into a movie, they just focus on a few moments of that book, right? And it's usually just the most important moments, but sometimes they miss the details. When you think about the Lord of the Rings movies, right? They took hundreds, if not thousands of pages of those books, and they boil them down into three movies. Long movies, right? But three movies. But even still, they zoom in on only a few parts of the entire story. And the gospel writers do something similar. They record Jesus' birth. Two of them do, at least. Then they record 3 years of ministry. And then they spend 40% on this 1 week alone. In fact, the gospels record in the neighborhood of about 40 events. 40 events that happen in this 1 week. When we consider the final week of Jesus' earthly life, many of us think of Palm Sunday. We're aware of what happens on Palm Sunday. We're aware of what happens on Good Friday. We know that nothing happens on Saturday, right? And then we're pretty aware of what happens on Easter Sunday. But everything else gets a little bit fuzzy, does it not? It's hard to remember what happens on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday, and even, you know, we know the Lord's Supper happens on Thursday, but what else happens that day and we kind of forget. So here's what I'm going to do. For this week, for this last week of Jesus Christ, Each day, I'm going to post to MABC's social media pages, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and I'm going to post a daily devotional. What happened that day in the life of Jesus Christ? So think of it as an electronic devotional. Now, I know some of you don't care for the digital side of life, right? That's not really your cup of tea. So we've printed 50, only 50, copies of the devotional, and it's available at our fancy new connection desk. That's the long desk with the marble on top. If you haven't seen it, you should go find it. But if you can do digital, please do digital, because we only printed 50 on purpose. So if you can, if you don't do digital, grab a copy, but please only one per household. There's going to be two passages per day. So today it's in Matthew 21, 1 through 11, Mark 11, 1 through 11. The only reason I remember that is because I read it this morning. Otherwise, I wouldn't. But every day there's going to be two passages. It's not going to cover everything that happens that day because it would be more than you would care to read, I know. But we want to prepare what happens this week. Let's elevate the importance of this Holy Week, this final week of Jesus Christ, and see what exactly happens. I read those two passages in about 5 minutes, so I promise it shouldn't take too long. So read those each day. It's to encourage your faith, and it's to remind us of the importance of this week. Remind us of the importance of what Jesus did this week, and encourage us to invite others to hear about it. Now, I've given you a bit of a 30,000-foot view, but instead, let's zoom in on our passage today. Now, if we were to read the chapters before this one, the passages before this one, we would see that Jesus, he's gone from having 12 people following him, and now his crowd is starting to grow bigger and bigger. In one of the passages, we're told of Jesus healing a blind man. And in the details that we're giving is that Jesus is just walking through his town on his way to Jericho, and the crowd is so loud and so large that the blind man inquires, "Who's walking by?" And they tell him, "It's Jesus." And that blind man cries out to Jesus, "Heal me." And long story short, Jesus does. So his already large crowd starts to grow even bigger. Jesus then passes through Jericho, where his crowd is large enough that little Zacchaeus, if we could sing the song, right? Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and Zacchaeus had to climb up into a sycamore tree all just so he could see Jesus. Could you imagine? I'm telling you, I don't care what celebrity passes by my house, I'm not climbing in a tree to see him. Right? I don't care if it's Peyton. I'm not doing it. It don't matter. Von Miller maybe, but that's about it. I might just try to give him a hug. But Jesus is walking through Jericho, and his crowd is so big, and Jesus is so compelling that Zacchaeus climbs up into a tree, an adult, an important adult. You imagine the mayor climbing up into a tree. He does it. As Jesus approaches Jerusalem, the crowd following him just continues to swell. Bigger and bigger and bigger. Even as those who are on a pilgrimage to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover, they're joining in because they've heard of him. They're fascinated by him. It is this crowd that the gospel writers tell us, they throw down their coats, they lay them out, and they pick up palm branches and wave as Jesus approaches Jerusalem, riding on the colt of a donkey. This crowd, though, is a fickle one at best. They praise Jesus on Palm Sunday. They praise Jesus on Palm Sunday, but at the end of the week, they are nowhere to be found. By Friday, where are they? Jesus, his triumphal entry, then, is just a glorious charade. It's just a charade. It's glorious because Jesus' followers are recognizing that Jesus is a king. And they're fulfilling what Zechariah 9:9 prophesies about Christ. It says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he. Humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. Now, throughout Israel's history, the heirs of King David, of David and Goliath fame, they would ride into Jerusalem on their coronation day, when they're coronated, proclaimed king. So people would, back then, they would take off their coats or their outer garments, and they would throw them on the road, and they would create sort of like a red carpet for us today and greet a royal figure as he would ride into Jerusalem on a colt, proclaimed king. But according to verse 37, the disciples and multitudes with them began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice. They believe it is not Jesus is their eternal Savior, but they're proclaiming Jesus as their earthly Savior. So they cry out with great joy because they believe that the king is riding into Jerusalem on a colt and he's going to overthrow Rome. He's going to kick out the invaders and set everything right for Israel and bring in a golden age. But little do they know that Jesus will. He will set everything right, does he not, church? Jesus does set everything right, but he doesn't do it on a throne. He doesn't do it on a throne, he does it on a cross. He doesn't do it with a crown of jewels, but with a crown of thorns. Jesus doesn't set everything right by going to war with Rome and defeating them. He sets everything right between humanity and God. And we want Jesus to meet our expectations, but it rarely, if ever, works out that way. Now, have you ever gone into something with great expectations only to have a bad experience? Has that ever happened to you? Hopefully not church today. So maybe it's a movie. You have great expectations for a movie or a restaurant or a vacation only to be a little bit disappointed. Now, a couple of summers ago on a family vacation, we had this type of experience. We went to Nashville for a North American Mission Board conference. And after that, we decided we're going to drive to Cleveland, Ohio, to see family. That's the only reason you go to Cleveland, is just to see family. So on our way, we spent the night in one of those hotels that are a water park. You familiar with those? It's a hotel slash water park, kind of like Great Wolf Lodge, right? There's one of those in the Springs. Only that where we stayed was no Great Wolf Lodge. It was no Great Wolf Lodge. The water was cold. More than half of the slides were not working. How does a slide not work? It has one function, right? You get on it, you slide, and you're in the water. But they were not working. And as it turns out, Jonathan was too short for the slides that were open. Right? Poor guy. So the website, right, when you're planning your trip and you're going and you're Googling and you're asking around, the website made the place look like creme brulee. Right? When in fact it was Jell-O. And not even name brand Jell-O, right? Like store-bought Jell-O. It was all a charade. The experience did not match our expectations. The website put forth this wonderful facade, but it wasn't true. It was a charade. As we got there and experienced it, we realized it'd be great to get our money back. The same thing is true for Jesus' experience that day. He's riding into Jerusalem. They're proclaiming him king, but all they're putting forth is a facade. It's a charade. It's a charade because Jesus goes into Jerusalem to glorious praise, but he leaves Jerusalem to mocking and jeers. Anything but praise. Jesus enters Jerusalem riding a colt, but he leaves Jerusalem carrying a cross. It's a charade because Jesus enters proclaimed a king and exits proclaimed a criminal. In less than a week, those cheering abandon him. None of this, though, is a surprise to Jesus. None of it is a surprise to him. He is in complete control of the situation. And there's nothing more clear of that than in this passage. That Jesus is in absolute, complete control of the situation. Do you see it? In verses 30 through 34, he tells his disciples, enter into the village. In the village, at the spot, you're going to see a colt. The colt is tied up. Untie the colt. But if somebody stops you and says, wait, what are you doing with my colt? Just say, the Lord has need of it. And what happens? The two disciples, they go into the village, and everything that they see is exactly like Jesus tells them to do. Now, I don't know about you, but if they come in asking for my car, and they say the Lord has need of it, I'm saying to them, no, right? I'm not handing them over my car keys. And yet somehow Jesus knew that that answer would be enough. That they would tell that person, the Lord has need of it. And in fact, if you come into my office and say, Mark, Jesus has need of your truck, I'm calling the police. Right? I love you, but I'm calling the police because I'm a little worried about you. But it happens exactly like Jesus tells them. Jesus is in complete control. He is in complete control of the situation. He knows where the colt is tied up. He knows that it has never been ridden. He knows the exact words that his disciples need in order to have the colt released to them. Jesus' knowledge shows that he is in complete control over the entire situation. And even though Jesus enters Jerusalem to applause, only to leave to shouts of anger, doesn't mean that he's any less control than he was on that first day. Nothing happens outside of his knowledge, outside of his direction, or outside of his control. This is true even today. That nothing happens outside of Jesus' knowledge, outside of Jesus' direction, or outside of Jesus' control. And one area of my life that I have no control over is simply the number of children that Janet and I have. We have no control over it. Now, every year, it's a fun thing to do, you know, every day. And on Facebook, it pops up on this day. Do you ever have that experience? And you see the pictures or the posts that you put a year before or 2 years before or 5 years before. So for us, the day after Christmas, it's a fun tradition just to sit down and see those pictures. Because the day after Christmas, 2008, we were in Austin, Texas, in anticipation of Parker's birth, our oldest son, Parker. We hurried to the hospital that morning, and Jane and I together, we waited impatiently outside of the hospital room. And we're standing there, and just outside of the room, and we hear his first cry. We're not in the room. We're just outside of the room. Our ears are almost plastered to the door, right? If we could look through a keyhole, we would have probably tried. So we hear his first cry, and moments later, just a few seconds later, we're brought into the room to see our newborn son. Precious. It was probably the last time he was precious, right? As Parker's birth mom hands him over to Janet. There's even a great picture where Parker reaches out his hands to Janet, almost as though the Lord has told him who his mom is. And a few days later, we get to bring him home. Many of you know this story, though. 8 months later, Jonathan is born. Little did we know that while we waited outside of the birthing room, Janet was already pregnant with Jonathan. Both births were an absolute miracle. We weren't supposed to be able to have kids of our own, biologically our own. Michelle picked us to parent Parker. God directed Michelle's heart, and she picked us to be Parker's mom and dad. And a short time later, another miracle happens, 8 months later, and Jonathan is born. Now here we are about 8 years after Parker's birth, and we are no more in control of how many kids we can have now as we were then. On March 1st of 2013, we submitted paperwork to adopt a third child. And here we are, 4 years later, and we don't have a third. We are not in control. We are absolutely not in control. And for us, from about, you know, March 1st of 2013 till about this time last year, we had many struggles, many hard days, many tears shed, many disappointments. After we knew that birth mom after birth mom picks another family to parent her child. We don't know. We honestly just stand here. We have no idea if ultimately we're supposed to be a family of five or to stay a family of four. But either way, we know that Jesus is in complete control. We know that Jesus is in complete control. We knew that Jesus wanted us, for whatever reason, to put our paperwork in March of 2013. We knew that. God wants us to submit our paperwork. And then we, for some reason, for 4 years, time after time after time, and just a little bit of pride here says, why wouldn't you pick us? What better family would there be? Right? Time after time, call after call, birth mom has picked a different family. We even had a nursery set up. And I don't know what it's like. I can't tell you. I can't describe for you what it's like to every day walk past a closed door of unmet expectations. The desire of our heart. And to see a bed empty that we longed to be filled. And yet we can stand here to say and say, Jesus is in complete control. And just because he is in control doesn't mean it will all work out. Right? According to your wants or my wants and my desires. Just because Jesus is in complete control, and just because we think that we would be a great family for any number of children, just one please, but we know that we would be a great family for a child, just because we want that, and it's not met, and we were reminded every single day with an empty crib, we were reminded every day of an unmet desire. And yet I can stand here before you and say with confidence, Jesus is in complete control. And we may not want to hear it, but we can take heart because Jesus always has our best interests in mind. He always has our best interests in mind. God always wants the very best for us, and he doesn't withhold those good things from us. So even if our desires are unfulfilled, our deepest longings and desires are unfulfilled, Jesus still has our best interests in mind. Always. You may have ample excuse to doubt him, but that doesn't change the reality that Jesus is in complete control. Now, for those of us in Christ, for those of us who have faith in Jesus Christ, who have knowingly placed our faith in Christ, there is comfort that he is in control. But for those who are not in Christ, for those who have not believed in Jesus' death and resurrection, the fact that Jesus is in complete control should actually bring you great discomfort. It shouldn't bring you happiness like it brings me. If you have not knowingly place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, willingly decided to follow him, the fact that he is in control should make you nervous. Because Jesus' control is bad news for those outside of Christ, for those who reject him. Because we have here a city, the city of Jerusalem, that rejects Christ, and it's bad news. We're going to see in these next few verses that we're going to read, the cost of rejecting Jesus. In verses 41 through 44, it says, "And when Jesus drew near and saw the city, he wept over it, saying, 'Would that you, even you, had known on this day the things that make for peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes. For the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up a barricade around you and surround you and hem you in on every side and tear you down to the ground, you and your children within you. They will not leave one stone upon another in you, because you did not know the time of your visitation." Now, as the previous passage comes to a close, Luke offers a bit of foreshadowing of what is to come. Now, the Pharisees tell Jesus, in just the verses before, they tell him, "Rebuke them." They tell Jesus to rebuke his disciples for worshiping him as the Messiah. The Pharisees' response shows that they refuse to believe Jesus is who he says he is. As one person explains, the request of Jesus to rebuke them betrays their view that the disciples are acting in opposition to the will of God. And accordingly, their lack of comprehension concerning the divine purpose, and particularly Jesus' status before God, is exposed. They reveal what they believe. A Pharisee's rejection of Jesus as Messiah leads to Jesus' prophecy in verses 41 through 44. As Jesus approaches the city, he begins to weep because he knows what's coming. But notice, while the crowds are cheering, only one person is crying. No one else wept. Because of his divine nature, Jesus had insight that no one else has. Only Jesus has it. And filled with sorrow, this moment that he's being declared king, Jesus is filled with sorrow because he knows the fate of Jerusalem. He knows that when they reject him, it seals their fate. A fate that is fulfilled just a few decades later. Because Jerusalem rebels against Roman rule. And the Romans come in, and they do exactly what Jesus says is going to happen. They take the city apart, brick by brick, piece by piece, until there's no Jerusalem there anymore. In fact, their destruction was so complete that there is no country called Israel from about 70 AD until 1949. Almost 19 centuries pass. Their destruction was so complete because it costs to reject Jesus. It costs to reject Jesus. The triumphal entry of Jesus was not a triumph. And what has been true from the very beginning of his ministry is true even now. The Son of God is rejected. People reject him every day. And for Israel, the rejection of Jesus as their king, as their Messiah, their Lord, their Savior, resulted in the destruction of their country. It resulted in the destruction of their country, their city, their temple, and their dispersion throughout the world. So broad was their destruction, it took 19 centuries to build it back. So anyone in this room who has never knowingly, willingly surrendered your life to Jesus Christ, don't care what your parents believe, don't care how you were raised, not too worried about how often you come to church or what you give, that is unimportant when it comes to salvation. Who is Jesus to you? Do you receive him as Lord and Savior, or do you reject him as an imposter? Anyone in this room who has never surrendered their life to Jesus Christ as your Lord, as Savior, as your boss, you will also face a costly fate. It's not a cost that God gives. It's a cost that you earn. You earn it with your sin. So God tells us that everyone in this room is a sinner. And the penalty of your sin, the debt of your sin, is death. Because you sin, someone has to die. God loves us so much that he sent his Son to pay that debt, to die that death. He did it for us. The debt of your sin and mine was paid for at the cross. He paid for it. Now, while Jesus dies for everyone, he dies for everyone, the payment of this debt only applies to those who surrender to him. It only applies to those of us who surrender to Jesus. So it is not enough to assume that you're a Christian, to assume that the debt of your sin was paid by Christ. It's not enough just to assume. You must knowingly, willingly, actively surrender your life to Jesus Christ. The alternative is to reject him. There's only two paths. There's only two choices. There is no door number three. You accept Christ, you reject Christ. For those who assume, it's a rejection. For those who knowingly, willingly surrender their life to Jesus Christ, you receive salvation. Jesus is a costly sacrifice. He is our costly sacrifice. Because if you reject his sacrifice, if you reject his death that paid for your sin, it will cost you. It will cost you. And church, it should burden us. It should burden us that there are people that we encounter every single day. It should burden us that there are people that we encounter every single day who assume that they're going to heaven. They assume that because they were born in America or that they went to church, they may even assume that because they were baptized, sprinkled or dunked or whatever, they assume that they're going to heaven even though they never surrendered their life to Christ. So we must take that opportunity. Take that obligation, understand our responsibility, and introduce those people to Jesus Christ. And say, it is not about where you were born. It is not about what your parents believed. It's not about how you were raised. It's not even about the fact that you're a good person. Have you willingly, knowingly surrendered your life to Jesus Christ? And continue to submit to him every single day. If you do so, you will be saved. So the people we encounter this week, people who are still fascinated with Jesus, people who maybe even would have joined that crowd and shouted for him, praised him. Maybe they would have thrown down their coat for him. Maybe they would have waved a palm branch to him. That's all well and good on Palm Sunday, but where are you after Easter? Are you an Easter people or are you a Palm Sunday person? Which one are you? If you're an Easter person, you follow him with your life. If you're a Palm Sunday person, you follow him for a moment. And only those who believe in Jesus Christ are Easter people. So let us desire that of ourself. If you are not an Easter person, consider surrendering your life to Jesus Christ, and I can promise you there's no better life to live. And if you are already an Easter person, then understand you are responsible. You are responsible for your neighbor, your friend, your classmate, your colleague, your family. Just extend them an invitation. Bring them with you. Buy them a donut if you must. But bring them that they may hear the good news of Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Holy Spirit, we ask for you to move in this place, to move in this hour, to move with us. If there is anyone who has not received you as their Savior and their Lord, I pray that they will do so today. And for the rest, Lord, those of us who have, I pray that we will do everything we can to encourage, to facilitate, to share, to do whatever we can to introduce people to the gospel. That, Lord, our faith will not be a charade, but it will be genuine and it will be true. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. If you would like to become a Christian today, Bryce, Bill, and I will be standing down front, and we would love to visit with you about how you can do it. If you would like or in need of prayer, we would love to pray with you. Or even if you would like to join this wonderful church, we'd be here for you to help and to encourage you. Let me ask everyone to stand as Foster leads us in song.
Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still.
Let's pray. Lord, we come before you this morning just grateful for the amazing mercy and grace you've shown us and will continue to show us. We're grateful, Lord, that we know that you are here with us this morning in this building and in this room. We worship you, Lord, and we ask as we continue to worship that you will just take our tithes, our gifts, you bless them, multiply them, and use them to expand your kingdom. We ask all these things, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, Emmanuel. Well, I don't know about you, but yesterday was about as beautiful of a day as you could ask for. Can I get an amen on that? And we are praying that we have that same weather this coming weekend, right? As we go into Holy Week, we've got a lot of things going on this week we're excited about as a church family. We will have a Good Friday service, as the pastor mentioned, at 6 o'clock. On Saturday, we're having what we're calling an extravaganza on the lawn from 2 to 4. That's for all the community, anybody with kids, grandkids, neighbors, those types of things. It'll be just an afternoon of an egg scramble, fun and games. And then next Sunday, we'll have two services, 8 o'clock and also at 10:45 with a small group Bible study in between. And so as the pastor mentioned, take those cards that are in your bulletin, hand those out. We've got more at the Connect Center. We'd love for you to share the news about MABC, and more importantly, the news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, not just about the church, but about the gospel of Jesus Christ. Do that for us next week, if you would mind. Also, we do have a garage sale training meeting today, I believe at 4 o'clock. That Pastor Bill will be doing that. So if you're interested in helping with that, it's coming up in early June, but there's some training that needs to be done. That'll be at 4 o'clock today. And also, I know Easter is next week, but we've got a lot of things going on the week after that, the weekend after that. So make sure you pay attention to your bulletin. And one thing in particular, we still need about 20 more volunteers for the 9 Health Fair. All right, so we're looking for 20 people. I'm not going to do what some churches do and stand here till I get 20 people to stand up. I'm going to trust you that 20 of you will sign up at the Connect Center. Miss Michelle would really appreciate that. We are in need. In particular, if you have any medical experience in the medical field, we need some volunteers in that area. And that is on April the 25th, okay? That's a great day. We're expecting anywhere from 500 to 1,000 people to come through our doors that day, okay? So it's a great opportunity to meet the community around us and to get to know them and share the love of Jesus Christ with them, okay? So I need 20 folks at least to sign up for that today, okay? Thank you very much. If you're uncomfortable walking an aisle, I do want to mention this. Pastor Bill, Pastor Mark, and I will be down front at the end for a few moments. I know sometimes it's uncomfortable to walk down front. Everybody's watching. We'll be down here for a few moments. We would love to tell you about Jesus. Everybody has a story. Just as Zacchaeus climbed the tree to see Jesus, Some of us have climbed trees, some of us have run, but God's always found us. And we would love to share our story with you and hear your story and help you come into a relationship with Him as well. You may want to join the church, you may want prayer, whatever that may be, we would just love to meet with you. We'll be down front at the end of the service for a few moments, and we'll be glad to welcome you at that point, okay? Foster?
So a little over a month ago, you prayed for myself and my family as we went to Arapahoe Road and led them in worship. I wanted to let you know officially, it went well, and next Sunday, Easter, will be my family's last Sunday with you. So, it's going to be hard to leave you, but we are really excited about where God is sending us, and I'm really excited for you as what God is going to be doing with you. Mississippi Avenue is such an amazing, amazing congregation. You guys are awesome. You've supported us, and I see huge, huge things in your future. I know God is moving. So give God a round of applause. And then please stand with me as we sing in closing a chorus. Do you remember?
Down in the valley where waters rise, I'm still believing, hope is alive. And all through the struggle and darkest day, I'll remember the empty grave.
Remember that, the empty grave was for you. God bless you. Have a great week.